one who was, and is to come. Amen. There must be a full moon coming, noted a woman that I passed on my way home from the ballot drop box this past Tuesday. Her white husky hunched beside her in the morning drizzle, outfitted in rain gear, four brown booties, and yellow slicker. I didn't catch their complete sidewalk conversation, but I did hear her fellow dog walker reply as he wrangled the leash of his chihuahua, also a huddle of white. Oh, it was last night, a full moon and an eclipse. Whether we're puzzling over our pet's restless behavior or pondering thousand-point swings in the stock market, how do we make sense of the signs of our times? St. Paul's Banner Ministry, thoughtfully curated by the Welcome Team, lifts up our unfolding horizon here in the community of Burlingame. Construing the signs of our times together, it invites us to welcome our neighbors and passersby to join us as we engage in that human discernment of a life-giving response. This quiet witness may seem like hidden work, the impact of which we may never fully know. But taking a stab at speaking to the questions that swirl around us and daring to incorporate them into our vision as a community of connection and care, this is a powerful ministry. Making sense of what is unfolding in the world is a task that has perplexed people for millennia. Even Jesus' own disciples, hardly pundits and prognosticators, even they attended to the swirling details of worldly goings-on in their day. In today's gospel, their attention peaks at Jesus' pronouncement about the temple's imminent destruction. Even though they weren't Californians, I suspect their bodies braced at his mention of wars, droughts, earthquakes, and persecutions. The Jewish people, after all, the people they were part of, as their identity as faithful believers in God, the Jewish people have known centuries of suffering, exile, and subjugation. Prophetic voices long had grappled with accelerating change in the ancient world, and these voices regularly predicted future cataclysm, tying end of times destruction to spiritual causes. These narratives primed people to be on the lookout, like farmers perusing their almanacs, midshipmen gazing at night skies, and techies tuning into the Twittersphere. The Jewish apocalyptic tradition, this tradition of thinking about what will happen at the end of time, emerged as early as 200 BCE, long before Jesus was born. The narratives in this apocalyptic tradition cast the story as one of God's final judgment on all the earthly forces of evil and God's salvation for the faithful remnant. And these stories were intended to comfort suffering communities, communities that struggled to bear up as they waited for God's redemption. The coming Messiah would right all wrongs and usher in God's timeless reign of justice and peace. This was the hope for which they waited. Now, by Jesus' time, this apocalyptic tradition had been shaped by painful history. Suppression of Judaism was intensifying after Alexander the Great's empire dissolved. Egypt and Syria emerged as the dominant powers in that era. Seleucid kings, those are the ones from Syria, ruled Jerusalem and its surrounding areas, and they placed increasing pressure on the Jewish people to turn away from their practices of faith and to conform to Greek ideals, including polytheism. Amid this sort of faith-based oppression, the Jewish people naturally revolted. Successful wars of independence staged by the priestly Judas Maccabeus and his family resisted the reign of tyranny through guerrilla warfare, encoded in this apocalyptic narrative that was hard for outsiders to decipher. God's salvation was coming to liberate an oppressed people, and this helped the people persist in the face of their suffering. These stories also stirred their courage amid persecution, bolstering the spirits of the Jewish people without raising the eyebrows of those in authority. Okay, I know, I've gone on quite a bit, so why am I geeking out about biblical history this morning? Why does it matter that this genre of biblical literature is echoed in Jesus' words in the Gospel of Luke? Well, I think it does matter. Jesus is pointing not only his friends back then, but also us, to a concern that we share with our wider world. Like all people, we are weathering global instability, economic uncertainty, and even institutional decline. The temple in Jerusalem was that paradigmatic emblem, cherished, a sign that God's presence was with the people, protecting and preserving their heritage forever. Maybe St. Paul's feels a little bit like that kind of spiritual icon in our lives, too. We look around in the wider world and see all that is being shaken. If not crumbling, then at least getting a little destabilized by the shifting ground on which society presently is positioned. I'm not talking about last month's 5.1 earthquake, but I did feel it the day that it struck. No, Jesus' apocalyptic tone is really inviting all of us, his disciples back then and us today, to face the truth of reality in all of its fluidity, even in its rawness. Whether he's talking about the impermanence of human institutions in all times and in all places, or directing our gaze right here and now to the many transformations that are taking our world by storm, in his speaking, symbolically and prophetically, about his own death and resurrection in those predictions, there was that layer in there, the temple being destroyed and rebuilt. You know, Jesus is talking about his own life being given and then being raised from the dead. But he's not only talking about something future and spiritual and world-shaking in its own right, as the resurrection surely was. He is naming the practical everyday challenges that our world, whatever the era, weathers any time the change unfolds. Jesus tells his disciples, now as then, do not be terrified. Sometimes it's hard not to be afraid, right? And I don't think God is saying, don't do that, you're not faithful if you're fearful. God is saying, there is more. Lift up your gaze. See what is there behind these signs. If we're to take encouragement and even challenge from this idea, if we're to feel the Holy Spirit's comfort inviting us to be still and to know that God is God, even as we glimpse things that we love passing away, even as we look toward what God yet is making within and around us, we have something that we can do to anchor ourselves in that comfort and grace. The invitation to this kind of consolation is tucked right there into our epistle reading that Bill read for us this morning. The letter writer to the church in Thessaloniki was inviting that community, a Greek community, also Hellenistic, to open up to God's movements that were unfolding in their lives, just as they surely unfold in ours. There was a line in there that talked about working quietly, doing the work of our daily lives. I think there's something for us there this morning. Quiet work for St. Paul's in this time takes many steady forms of faithfulness. Hosting a coffee hour, for example. Helping little ones frost cookies at the Advent festival. Washing and ironing linens for worship. Baking our communion bread. These are the little things that mean so much as we hold space for God's future to emerge. They're one of the many thousand little things that ground us in God's goodness day by day. Leaning into that presence works with communities to engage in dialogue and discernment at this stage of the pandemic. I got to thinking about how St. Paul's has been living into this desire to hold that space, to honor diverse risk tolerances within our community and the wider circles in which we orbit, including our communal questions and considerations of when and how we might resume sharing the communion cup. Listening to his stories and thinking about our experiences, I was able to see that commitment that our church is holding space for, commitment to inclusion, to care for the most vulnerable, as we prioritize safeguarding our wellness with curiosity, kindness, and generosity of spirit, that kind that quietly reveals God's love, enfolding all of us. Sign number three. On Thursday, someone from St. Paul's shared about their recent encounter with an unhoused neighbor. It was a one-on-one conversation, and the unexpected opportunity that emerged in that connection to see someone else's humanity allowed this person to feel gratitude, sparking kindness in a way that surprised even the one who decided to offer the help in a form and a fashion that blessed beyond the wildest expectations, the one who is seeking support. I wonder what you witness as signs of our times. As we look around and see many in our world responding to the shifting realities in fear or frustration, Jesus' voice comforts us with this challenge to endure, walking the path of faith together, quietly, doing everything we can to be people of courage and hope. What part of that quiet work of God's love might be yours to join in at St. Paul's as we live into this new season of our life together? What ministry might you feel stirred to take up as you respond to the call of the Holy Spirit in your life? Hers may well be that powerful portent language of full moons and eclipses, but she often comes